Are you back with a model or Spartan or both? What I decided to do to simplify the model is draw in my H because I'm building it in the model anyway. And I decided to make my ethyls just an orange ball just so I can not have an issue with too much crowding, and wanted to clarify that. So here's my methyl. I'm gonna make this sort of orange atom here. That's my ethyl. I have another ethyl here. They're trans to each other. And then I have an H right here. That's always white. The whole reason I'm doing this exercise is because we have been making sure to draw alkenes planar, because they are. All of the groups, if you built your model correctly, by the way, if you built the model with your handheld models, use the bendy bonds, the really long, flexible ones, to make your pi bond. Okay? If you don't do that, you won't get two of them together. But notice that it's planar, which illustrates why things can come from above the alkene just as well as below, without any steric difference in steric hindrance. So because it's planar, we usually find it much simpler to keep everything in the plane. See, look at these lines. The bonds are all drawn this way as opposed to dashes and wedges. But if we have prochiral centers, potentially, we're gonna have dashes and wedges that must be drawn precisely correct to indicate the proper stereochemistry. One way to do that without getting lost at all the possible stereoisomers that could form is to draw this completely out of the plane. So this is just a problem solving strategy for this type of problem, for the alkene chapter. Normally, yes, we draw alkenes in the plane, but when it's time to react alkenes and we know that reaction could result in a stereocenter, formation of a stereocenter, it's useful for your brain to work out the dashes and wedges while it's easy before waiting till the end. So what do I mean by while it's easy? If you take this model and you choose one way, either flip it towards you or away from you, I like to take the bottom groups, so the H and the ethyl in that case, and just bring it toward me. So it's perpendicular to the plane of the paper now. So that means this could also be drawn this way. And so it could be planar out of the plane of the paper. Still planar with each other, still creates a plane. So in other words, if I bring the bottom groups up out at me, they would both be wedges. But as soon as I do that, I push the top groups back. So those are dashes. So everything's out of the plane. Okay, there's my ethyls. Why did I do that? That's so I can pay attention to the relative stereochemistry going on here. And I'm gonna use that to solve this problem. All right, I'm gonna go with this now. So that makes my brain hurt a lot less than working out how I got each of these in the end. So what's the beauty of this? Is I can actually take, when I do the first step of the mechanism, which is to have this attack, and this come, one of the lone pairs, come back down and grab it, and then this kicks off. I can let this, oops, let me draw that again. Did not let me undo it. That attacks and this comes back. Okay, so normally in the previous mechanism, when I did that, that means this was either a dash or a wedge because I was keeping the alkene in the plane of the paper. So that means either the cyclopropane looking thing, the bromonium ion, came out at you or went away from you. But now the alkene is going out and away from you, which means the bromonium ion could be in the plane above or in the plane below. So we can have both options, but it's in the plane, so it gets drawn with lines. So in other words, I take this same framework and my bromonium ion is going to be planar above or planar down low. And on each of those carbons, if I call this carbon 1 and 2, I get to just copy, without thinking, the dashes and wedges, which is really nice because I need dashes and wedges later and they stay the same. So ethyl stays there. Because that's a down carbon, these groups point down. So I do maintain that. I'm drawing my H2 just to keep it clear. So we get both of these, right? The above and below the plane. So on carbon one, it's the same, only I just let it point up. Methyl, ethyl, and ethyl, H. Okay, so this takes care of the addition of the bromine to one of the carbons, but because I'm forming a halohydrin, I get an OH on the other carbon, not another bromine. Get a mix of them. So now I gotta get the water or the alcohol, but in this case, water was given as my nucleophile. So here's water, and here's water down here. Now note what happens. Note that the nucleophile still followed Markovnikov's. The nucleophile ended up on the more substituted H. The OH ended up on the more substituted carbon. The bromine that got attacked is on the less substituted carbon. So this time it's not an H going to more H's, a carbon with more H's, it's a bromine. The nucleophile here is going to attack the more substituted carbon. That should bother you a little bit, because the arrow we're about to draw is supposed to represent a SN2-like backside attack, right? So who's the most substituted carbon? Carbon one, right? Backside attack to open. Carbon one, backside attack to open. What do I mean by backside attack? Luckily, I made the leaving group in the plane, which means I get to draw the new group in the plane. Like I said, my brain's done with dashes and wedges. I just copy them now. So that's the good thing. Let's work on drawing the product before we get upset about the fact that we did a backside attack. Okay, so here's our product. I have to draw both. So I'm just gonna draw them in order. So product, the left one had a water attack from the bottom. We still have water, it's not an alcohol yet. And it opened up the bromine, so it's carbon one and two, to there. Notice that framework, that's an anti-framework. They're anti to each other. We maintain that anti-relationship because of that ring. I gotta fill in my dashes and wedges on carbon one. Guess what, they stay the same. Because the only things that changed were the things in the plane. That simplifies it greatly, right? Now the bottom, that stays the same. Just make sure you draw, obey the like down carbons, get the down dashes and wedges, that sort of thing, and you'll be in good shape. All right, now what happened here is that the water attacked from above here, so I need to have the OH going up. So I'm gonna draw an up, line across for one and bonded to two, and then this bromine that's down stays there, because that was our leaving group, and it stays attached to carbon two. So my sigma bonding framework looks something like this, right? With the new water here, and my old bromine leaving group there, carbon one and two. Dashes and wedges stay the same. Ethyl stays wedge, methyl stays dash. Keep that H there, and ethyl. Simple neutralizing will take us home. Water and more water. And I'm gonna circle these. These are two products. Okay, so something to point out about the mechanism here, the transition state. We're not gonna go over every transition state because there's multiple steps, but I am gonna draw one of them for you. So I'm going to draw the part where the bromine, bromonium ion is starting to open. So we know that the more substituted carbon, oh, I drew the ethyl as a line, so we'll do that. Okay, so the more substituted carbon was carbon one. So that's where the bond's gonna break from the bromonium ion. It's leaving there because the new group's gonna attack there. So if it's breaking, it's not a full plus, it's a delta plus in that transition state. But that means there is a partial carbocation character there, and it's on that more substituted carbon. I'll even put these in red. So just as it's good to have a more substituted carbocation, it's better to have a more substituted delta plus, right? It can stabilize a delta plus in the same way it would stabilize a full plus. Hence, the nucleophile is attracted to that one more because that's where it's most likely going to have the lower concentration of charge. So more delta plus character instead of electrons. So nucleophile is attracted there. So here it comes from the backside. And we'll draw on the dotted line there. So I'm drawing this one in green, that trajectory. So it's still a backside attack because the bond hasn't broken yet. But as it breaks, it builds up that delta plus, which makes that nucleophile more attracted to it. So this has characteristics of not only an SN2, the backside attack, has SN1 characteristics because it has the consideration we have to make for a delta plus or a carbocation. So this is therefore called a hybrid SN1, SN2. How is it like an SN1? The fact that the regiochemistry shows the attack of H2O on more substituted carbon because of the better carbocation. How is it like an SN2? The fact that it still maintains a backside attack. So it must not be totally concerted, right? Because if the new group attacked as the leaving group left, that would be an SN2. It wouldn't have the chance to kind of differentiate between which carbon's better as a carbocation, but it's still considered one step. We call that concerted, but asynchronous. So not exactly the same time, but so close in time that they're practically considered the same step. Okay, so let's summarize that again. Regioselectivity would be described as the nucleophile got added to the more substituted carbon. So it's like a Markovnikov arrangement, right? OH or OR. So if you use water, you add an OH. If you use alcohol, you add an OR. Goes to more stable, what would be the more stable carbocation? That's a good way to remember it because that's remembering why, right? So, in other words, of the two carbons, OH never went to that carbon. It only went to the one that's more substituted because it would make a better carbocation because it has this hybrid SN1, SN2 sort of transition state going on there. Stereoselectivity, strictly anti, still. We get a pair of enantiomers, right? These are exact opposite, so this is plus minus, but they are anti, the anti set only. Okay, that is worth a redo. Maybe for fun, change that water to ethanol or methanol, and just so it's switched up enough, and do this again yourself. This is hard. Hard but necessary. Okay, I'm not going to sugarcoat that. Use all these same approaches. I'm putting a star, it's a challenge, but it's not a special out of reach challenge. It's going to come up a lot, so make sure you're comfortable with it. There's a lot to consider there. A lot of concepts going on. Before we switch gears to oxidation and reduction. Okay, so go practice that. See you in a bit.